Slow motion. Do they introduce or do I just? He's gonna do it. Okay. Okay, can hear me? Okay, great. So welcome and thank you. Thank you, Adam, and thank you to the Music Academy in Bydgoszcz. I'm really pleased to be here. So we've called this American Mavericks, and what I want to do is there's a whole long history and legacy of experimentation with the piano coming from many different countries, but I'm speaking primarily about the United States. And one of the first sort of pioneers, he was considered a little bit eccentric at first, but his music has become basically considered classic or historic avant-garde at this point. And it's the American composer Henry Cowell, who was born and raised on the west coast of the United States in Northern California. And he was born at a time, 1897, but right near the turn of the century. This is when a lot of the settlements of a lot of the people from Asia, cultures from Japan and China, Korea, were settling in Northern California and in Canada as well. And so, in the areas around San Francisco where he was from, he was exposed to a lot of different kinds of music, a lot of music being played on the street by a lot of these different ethnic groups with some of their original instruments. He was trained a little bit classically. He has an Irish heritage, so the Irish folk music is a big part of his output as well. And what I want to do today is show you three different pieces that sort of express musically and philosophically some of his views. He was very much akin to wanting to write pieces that expressed actual life in music. Just human life and how it expressed itself that way. There's one piece that will sort of depict what he experienced in night in around 1917 in Times Square in New York City, which was not anywhere near as crazy or as active and bright as it is today, but there were still a lot of activity, lights, and all of that, and this affected his writing as well. I will also, he was very much interested in mythology and ancient stories. So one of the pieces will reflect that. And then one of the pieces, of course, will reflect his love of the Irish folk music, which infused a lot of his work. He wrote for the piano mostly in short form. There is a piano concerto, but he didn't write a lot of orchestral music. It was mostly for the piano, as he was a pianist himself. As I said, he was trained classically for. He had a wonderful teacher named Charles Seeger in Northern California. He studied for a while in New York City and then returned to California as well. And he was one of the first American pianists to travel to Europe and perform contemporary music, music by his peers, by Bartok, by Scriabin, and other composers living at that time. It is very curious too. He developed this idea of the tone cluster, which is what I want to focus on today with these three pieces. There, Henry Cowell, of course, is known for not only playing on the keyboard itself, but also going on the inside piano, what we call extended techniques, strumming, stroking, and plucking the inside strings. Unfortunately, we can't do that today via the disc clavier, but we will. I will, like I said, I will focus primarily on these cluster pieces. And you'll see, as I said, from the selection of three, the different approaches he uses. And I'd also like to talk a little about how to do some of these, because a lot of students are always asking, what is the correct approach to this? What is the safe approach to this, so that it doesn't hurt the piano or that you don't hurt yourself? Henry Cowell, of course, invented many different kinds of tone clusters. We know clusters, you can play them with your fingers. Obviously, it's any group of notes, chromatic notes together. And I can play that with just my fingers. He invented different, well, I have one question. Do you have the scores there that I sent? You do. Okay. You'll see that from the notation, He invented all different kinds of clusters. The first piece that I want to do, though, involves basically palm clusters, which are octave length, and full forearm clusters, which uses the forearm, this part of the arm. He also used, when he wrote like clusters that were the span of a perfect fifth, you can use, of course, you can also use your palm. I'm going to also talk about a technique called fist clusters, which we'll do in the second piece. And then they seem to all be combined in the final piece of his that I will perform. So this first piece, The Tides of Mananaun, this is one of the pieces that is based on a mythological sort of story. As he says here in the score, Mananaun was the god of motion. Long before the creation, he sent forth tremendous tides from the ocean, which swept to and fro through the universe and rhythmically moved the particles and materials of which the gods were later to make the suns and the worlds. So it's sort of this, he's trying to depict this extremely vast scenario of this godlike being who was able to move through the ocean and create all these different worlds and suns. So in light of that, Henry Cowell is basically depicting that here. He starts, as you can see at the beginning of the score, he's starting with just, as I talked about, these octave length palm clusters, which if you can see there, they're in the base of the piano. So one of the things you have to do is you have to make sure, and this is always tricky because it depends, every person is different. You have to make sure you have a good amount of pressure on the hands. This is different than regular piano playing in terms of finger weight and all of that. It's a different kind of weight. The same, if you look down on the third line, he has the two octave clusters, which are done with the forearm, and that's gonna be, so those, and again, one has to gauge the amount of weight that's on the front of the forearm. Now, one thing about notation, if you notice in this score, the right, the top staff, which is bass clef, he's marked with five flats. The bottom staff has only one flat. So basically what that is telling us is that the clusters in the, in the bottom staff are going to be played on white notes. Usually, and we'll see this in some of his other pieces, above the clusters, no matter what size the cluster is, perfect fifth, octave, double octave, he will put, it's usually based on the key signature, he'll put a sharp or a flat above the cluster. That means that you would only play the black notes. If it's a natural sign, you would only play the white notes, okay? If there is no sign, no flat, sharp, or natural, you play them chromatic. You play all the notes between the notes that he's given you. And as you can see, if you look on the second page of the Tides of Mananaun, the second line there, you'll see that there's these black bars and these white bars. That just is, that's his notation for playing all the notes in between. And you can see there, on that second page, you can see the flat, natural, flat, flat, natural. That's telling you to play black and white clusters based on what he's giving you there, okay? So I'm gonna play this now. And again, you'll hear as it opens quietly, it develops and builds into quite a dramatic climax. Again, depicting the whole god of Mananaun, the god of motion, as he's described here. Thank you. Okay. So we move to the next piece, which is called, hold on, let me just bring it up here. Hold on, give me 1 minute. Let me turn my pedal on. Okay. This is a piece called Advertisement. Now, this is one of those pieces that I mentioned that he was depicting life as he experienced it. And basically, this is a period he was in New York City. And while he was in New York City experiencing Times Square and the busyness of all the people, the buildings, again, this is 1917. It was a much, as I said, a much different place than what New York City's Times Square is now. But basically, he's also sociologically commenting on the American advertising system, which could be the advertising system in any country, whereby the way the system forces people to do things, buy this, look like this, eat this, do this, do this. So the constant pressure of pummeling people and insisting on things, he's trying to make a musical commentary on that. Now, here, he does it in a kind of playful manner. He's sort of also poking fun at it at the same time. And one of the things, one of the techniques he uses in here is that idea I mentioned earlier called the fist cluster, which is usually three or four notes that are played with the fist of the hand. Now, I should clarify here, the fist clusters, you'll see them in the score. It's any of those little, they look like thirds basically, or thirds or small chromatic clusters that have little X's above them. The X means that you would use your fist. Now, what I want to describe is how to use the fist. You do not play it with a closed fist for two reasons. One is the closed fist is too strong. If you are really too powerful, you could break a string, which we don't want to do. The other thing is that you could hurt yourself. So what a Henry Cowell fist is it's an open cupped hand like this, where the fingers are curved and you're playing by just bouncing the weight of the back part of the hand here on the keys. I'll give you an example. This is using like three key clusters. So basically it's just bouncing, whether, and again, one would decide, would distinguish whether it's going to be a white cluster, a white note cluster, or a black note cluster. He usually specifies that in this particular piece with this notation, you'll know whether it's going to be black notes or white notes or chromatic in between, okay? So the piece again, sort of is a little relentless at times. It's very short, but it sort of again makes this quasi-comical, humorous statement on a sarcastic statement, I should say, on the American advertising system way back when he was living at that time in New York. Okay.
Okay, next.
It's a little bit of, hold on. Let me just find, here we go.
Okay, so the next and last of these pieces was, and in fact, that was written in 1917. It was revised later on. It's curious that the previous piece I played, The Tides of Mananaun, was written in 1912, and it was one of the first experimentations with using tone clusters at that time. It's very curious because by the 1920s, when Henry Cowell traveled to Europe, he was performing a lot of his compositions for audiences around Europe, and they were sort of fascinated by this approach to playing, as well as playing some of the pieces that he had written on the inside strings of the piano as well. He was one of the first American pianists to actually perform in Russia, and they were so thrilled with what he was doing, they actually published one of his pieces, which is called Tiger. And Bartók, Béla Bartók actually heard one of Henry Cowell's concerts, and the gentleman that Bartók really wrote Henry Cowell a very kind letter asking permission if he could use the idea of tone clusters in his music, of which he then incorporated them into his piano sonata, as well as the out of doors suite. Obviously, Béla Bartók's Bartók's notation in the piano sonata, of course, is very different from Henry Cowell's, but it's along the same line. So getting back, in 1925, he wrote, this is another piece he wrote, they're based on a lot of the Irish folk music that he was so fond of. Remember, I emphasize again, he was raised hearing music from the East, classical music, as well as the music from his Irish heritage. So this fed his imagination in so many ways, in the way he conceived of sound, the way he heard sound. And I think a piece like this, it's called The Lilt of the Reel, R-E-E-L, which is an old Irish dance that was done in hillside towns. And you'll notice in this piece, he uses the double octave forearm clusters. He uses the palm clusters, which are perfect fifths. You can see some of that at the bottom of the first page. And then there are octave clusters, again, that'll also be played with the palm of the hand. He combines all three of these into this kind of very fun, kind of animated, if you will, take on this old Irish dance, where he says people oftentimes were able to bump in or smash into each other while they were dancing because some of the hillside towns were kind of imbalanced. So this is The Lilt of the Reel from 1925. And again, I want to emphasize the forearm. This is going to be different with every pianist, especially male and female. Everybody's arms are of different lengths. These double octave forearm clusters usually would be done from the elbow to the wrist. Sometimes, depending on the length of your arm, it has to go out to the knuckle. And for certain people, it has to go out to the pinky, depending on the length. For me, I have to gauge it so that it really stops at the edge of my wrist. Otherwise, I'll be playing extra notes. And that's the other challenge with the piece, is making sure that the melody comes out. In this case, the melody is at the top of the clusters. So your elbow basically is your pinky, the way we would normally, if you were playing Chopin, of course, you'd be voicing with your top, with the back fingers. Here, your elbow becomes that back finger, if you will. So this is The Lilt of the Reel from 1925. Thank you. Sorry, I was having trouble with my iPad turning the pages. So there were a couple of hesitations in there.
And my pedal seemed to
kick. I kicked my pedal. Good. Are there any questions before I go on? No? Okay. So that's Henry Cowell. I mean, there's a lot more to say about him, and there's a whole other side of playing on the inside strings of the piano, which are sort of classic avant-garde pieces, as I mentioned, his experimentation with that, which led to just a couple, maybe half a decade to two decades later, with John Cage, who studied with Henry Cowell briefly. John Cage took that experimentation further with the prepared piano by inserting different objects in between the strings of the piano to alter the timbre of each of the pitches. A couple of decades later, after the 1940s, when Cage was experimenting with that, the American composer George Crumb took that even a step further with some of his experimentation with the macrocosmos. But we save that for another time. What I'd like to do now is I'd like to talk a little about, before I go on to, sorry, I'm just looking for the score here. Here we go. Before I talk about Frederick Zhevsky, who is probably one of the most predominant American composers who wrote for the piano in the second half of the century and into this century. He's of Polish-American descent, and he has fed the repertoire within a very, very important and vast body of piano music. But previous to that, I just want to play a work by a composer named Niko Muhly. He is of the younger generation of American composers. And this is a piece, the reason I play this is a piece from a project that I have I created and have been working on the past 10 or 12 years, which is I commissioned a whole series of composers from multiple genres, not only classical, but also from the jazz world, the theater world, opera, indie, pop, as well as other genres, to choose a song by the American musical theater composer, Stephen Sondheim. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Stephen Sondheim's work in the theater, but he's one of the most predominant of American musical theater composers. And these composers each have chosen a song and reimagined it as a piano piece. And Niko Muhly, of course, has often been very much influenced by the work of some of the American minimalists like Steve Reich, like Philip Glass and John Adams and others. And what he has done is he has taken a piece from one of the shows that Stephen Sondheim wrote called Sunday in the Park with George, which is a musical theater piece about the life of the French painter, Georges Seurat. It focuses primarily on him creating his most famous painting, which is Sunday Afternoon on the Island of the Grand Jatte, which hangs at the Museum of Modern Art in Chicago. The story itself is Georges Seurat was so completely obsessed with his work. And of course, Georges Seurat was a process-based painter using pointillism, a lot of the fast dots that he used to create a sense of color. And as you stood back, the eye, basically your eye does the work with transforming those colors into images. And this was his genius. And Niko Muhly, like Steve Reich, are process-based composers. They have a specific process that they use. And in the story that Sondheim had written of Sunday in the Park with George, Georges Seurat is having trouble in his relationship with his girlfriend, who the character's name is Dot, kind of a play on the idea that he used dots, that method of pointillism in his work. And what Niko Muhly is doing is using certain minimal techniques, as well as others, he brings out the angular side or the tension in their relationship by using that. And you'll see that the technique of that idea is basically a metaphor for Georges Seurat and his method of painting. But he tempers this also with the more lyrical, tender moments in their relationship, the deeply felt love that the two characters had for each other. So he plays with both of these, the angular and the lyrical, back and forth. that sort of depicts this. So you'll hear this. This piece is called Color and Light. It is the name of one of the songs from the show Sunday in the Park with George. And it exists at a time when George is feverishly working away at the painting, and he gets into an argument with his girlfriend, who then ends up running off because they were supposed to have a social engagement together, which he's canceled because he insists that he has to work. Okay. Thank you.
So that gives you just an example of that. What I'd like to do now is move to talk about Fredrzewski. And as I said, I do consider him one of the most important of the composers for the piano in the second half of the century and into this century. He's currently living in Belgium. He was born and raised in Massachusetts, of Polish-American parents. He was educated at Harvard and Princeton. He studied with American composers Milton Babbitt and Roger Sessions. And in the 1950s, when he met John Cage, he said John Cage greatly influenced his work in a lot of ways by allowing him a certain amount of freedom in the way that he composed. By the time we got to the 1960s, he took a very strong interest in issues of social conscience, important historical events, in political subjects and ideas that were existing around the world. He moved to Rome in the 60s, he was married, and formed an improvisational electronic group called Musica Electronica Viva, which meant living electronic music. For about 20 or so years, they toured, he and three other musicians toured around Europe, performing live of improvisatory performances with him as the pianist. He was also one of the premier pianists being hired to premiere a lot of the new works being written. He was actually the first person to perform Stockhausen's massive Klavierstück number 10. And he had an amazing technique. What we find though with Rzewski is that because of his interest in important political subjects and issues of social conscience, he took an interest also in folk music from different areas around the world. And in the 1970s, his focus was primarily on South America, primarily in the country of Chile. And probably one of his most famous works is, and many of you may be familiar with it, is The People United Will Never Be Defeated, which is one of the most important sets of variations. It's 36 variations on this Chilean folk tune of that same title. By the end of the 20th century, The People United Will Never Be Defeated was considered to be one of the great sets of variations of the 20th century. It is now recognized as one of the great sets of variations in the history of music, right up there with the Bach Goldberg, the Beethoven Diabelli, the Brahms Paganini variations. Rzewski's style, if I were to encompass it in one word, it's eclecticism. Because he played so much contemporary music and so much classical music, he was an avid performer of Beethoven's music, so much so that he was caught at times in the middle of a Beethoven sonata improvising and then finding his way right back into the spot where he began the improvisation and finishing the sonata to the end. He believes that all musicians should compose, perform, and improvise. And many of his works do ask that the performer improvise at a certain point, for whether it's a minute or sometimes up to 5 minutes, on some of the material that he's already given you. He does this in The People United Will Never Be Defeated, and he does it in several other pieces. This focus, though, on on South American folk music, of which The People United was based, he came up with another set of pieces, which in 2 years later, in 1977, called The Four Pieces. These are all based on the same folk tune, which he originated himself, but he made it clear that it was based on or inspired by a folk song written by a Chilean guitarist, a folk guitarist who was mysteriously killed by the government for his outspoken views at the time. And there was great upheaval in Chile at the time when he was writing these pieces and when this performer was writing his own songs and performing them. Rzewski then has modeled it on this kind of peasant-like folk tune from the hills of Chile. And it's, as I said, it's used in all four pieces. What I want to do is focus on primarily piano piece number 4, the last of the four pieces. The entire four pieces are loosely structured in the form of a sonata, but the Chilean folk tune is most predominant, even though it's in the other three movements. It's very predominant in this fourth piece. And I just want to explain what he explains to the performer. You can see in the score there, he says, the notes should be stroked rather than struck, as if one were exciting a large gong. The object here being is to make the instrument speak throughout its entire spectrum. He plays a lot with the inside resonance of the piano. This is one of his signature ideas that he uses in his music. And at the end of the piece, he said there shouldn't be a feeling of finality or cadence, but something quite the opposite. It shouldn't be clear whether another sound is coming until, in fact, all sound has died away. This being a metaphor for the expectation and hopes of future developments. Again, he's playing on to the political ideas that were existing there. What you see in the score there at the beginning is you see this kind of wavy line that goes through these chords. What he's asking the pianist to do is repeat the chords approximately 6 or 8 times per note. And gradually you have to phase in the new pitches that form the chords. And then gradually as the chords move down, the chords will gradually move down the scope of the keyboard. And certain notes, of course, have to fade out while other notes find themselves being added in. And this basically creates a kind of vague kind of resonance on the inside of the piano. And then gradually what he does is he slowly builds up to presenting the actual folk tune. He does it in fragments. He does it in a kind of pointillistic manner. Now, remember I said that Jevsky's style basically is eclecticism. That encompasses a whole variety of different approaches that he's used in his music. I list here neoclassicism, serialism, chance music, jazz, rock and folk music. These are all ingredients of his art, if you will. And here, as I said, the folk tune will gradually evolve from this. And then he plays around with it in different ways. And then he does another wash of resonance up the keyboard using perfect fifths in the middle of the piece. And at the end, he does the same thing by forming other chords. The piece has a kind of dramatic flavor to it, but it's very typical of Jevsky's writing, not only his experimentation and his virtuosity, but also just the idea that he's been often labeled as the human realist. He shows a certain idea of realism true life that comes out in his music. And I think that's why so much of his music has appealed to even the average listener. Those that don't listen to classical music normally are very attracted to his music because there's a great appeal to it, because he's speaking to on so many levels of the human personality. And I think it's also very predominant in this last of the four pieces. Okay, so this is piano piece number 4. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any questions or anything before we move on? I can.
Have any idea? I mean, we're just thinking and talking here. Why is that Rzewski is not really popular in Poland, as he was Polish? We discussed it before, and it's for me, it's amazing how for some people in the US, Rzewski is more famous than Penderecki, which is completely the opposite right here. So do you have any idea how?
I would be curious to ask him that question, just to get what his answer is, because he's always extremely candid in his responses. But for myself, I simply don't know why he's not more popular in Poland. The curious thing is that, like I said, since the 1960s, he's lived in Europe. He's made, of course, many, many trips back to the United States, but he lived in Italy for a good 10 or 15 years. Then he moved to Belgium, where he lives currently. And he performs over the past 4 or 5 decades, he has been performing throughout Europe. And I have no doubt that he performed, he has to have performed in Poland. I know that he was invited many times to the Warsaw Autumn Festival.
But mostly as a performer, not as a composer, I would
assume. Yeah, the thing is, in the 60s and up into the 70s, he was mostly being asked to perform. Now, he made an interesting comment once. He said that composers were asking him to learn some of the most difficult music that was being written. At that time, of course, modernism had the stronghold throughout not only the United States, but as well as throughout Europe. And he said he started to feel that people only came to his concerts to basically see how he would manage the most difficult music. And he said he felt more like he was becoming a freak show than them coming to hear him play. And he started to infuse his concerts with more of his own music, along with classical music, and a lot of music of his colleagues that he felt strongly about, music he really believed in. So what I find interesting or curious is that he performs so much in Europe, he still does. He's 83 years old, and he's still being asked to perform at different festivals and in places all throughout Europe. I just don't understand. I mean, I would be curious to ask him how much he has played actually in Poland over the past 4 decades. I would have thought that his music was sort of commonplace now in Poland, because there's so much. I mean, I mentioned the People United, which we could do a whole class on because the piece is so massive. And so it really is one of the most emotionally, physically, and musically gratifying pieces to listen to. There's not only these 4 pieces that I've just talked about, but the 4 North American ballads, which are based on American folk music. And then there's just a vast array. He was so prolific, and he still is. And of course, he extended that to, he's one of the forerunners in the genre that I've been sort of credited with, a speaking, singing, pianist genre, where the pianist speaks or sings while playing. He wrote one of the most important pieces for that genre, which was called De Profundis, based on a text by Oscar Wilde. And it's a 30-minute sort of tour de force for a pianist who also speaks the text while they're playing. He calls it an oratorio for solo speaking pianist. And I mean, he's crossed boundaries. He uses a lot of accentuations on the outside structure of the piano, as well as the body. This is the, as I mentioned earlier, the freedom that he said he was given after working with John Cage in the 1950s and early 60s, he said that freed him up to go in the direction he wanted. And I think the idea that in his piano music, because it's so eclectic in its styles, I mean, the People United spans, I don't know, the People United spans so many different genres of styles throughout the 20th century. I call it basically a catalog of the 20th century. And I know that he is extremely knowledgeable on a lot of the Polish composers throughout the 20th century and maybe even currently. Maybe you want to invite him to the Academy to perform and to talk.
He's selective.
Yeah, he's very, you'll find he's very candid. He speaks his mind, which is why we all love him. You know, people used to be afraid to interview him because they said he used to end up interviewing the interviewer. and they felt very uncomfortable with that. But I wish I could have had a better answer for you as to why it's not played. I would just say, if you look online, curiously, most all the piano music now is available for download. He made that a possibility. The early works that, like the People United, the Four Pieces, the North American Ballads, those were published by the Japanese Zenon Music Press. After that, most everything is available. If you Google it, the ISLMP, they will, you can find that you can download. And most of it is in his manuscript, which is very readable. It's very clean and clear. But you'll see the enormous list of works. I mean, I wish we had time. I could talk about so many of the other works because some of them are very different, but you'll still see that this eclectic approach to writing is very, very much a part of his output.
So maybe I'll ask you another question.
Sure.
Because you're still very active in contemporary music field and modern new music and new repertoire. So the things we're discussing here today, it's mostly what was written very long time ago. So how would you, if, I know it's a vast subject, but if you would compare to what is being written now and what sort of techniques are implemented in it, would you consider it something completely different, or I don't know, would you suggest that there is like completely a different world for us pianists to learn these techniques?
I mean, I think that a lot of the extended techniques that were pioneered in the 20th century, like using the inside of the piano, not only clusters, but also the outside structure of the piano, as I mentioned, also working with electronics, tape and piano pieces, audio track. If you look at the history of electronic pieces starting back in the late 60s, early 1970s, because the technology with every decade kept revising itself and becoming more sophisticated, the composers, I think, in each generation went with that. They actually adapted to that. And what I found is that a lot of them use even live electronics on stage now for a lot of those pieces. And that's its own sort of technical approach, a whole technique that the pianist has to learn in terms of working with electronics and working with audio track. What I found in the young generation of composers now is a sort of growth or extension out of a lot of this. They are, you know, I find with a lot of my students and what I see with composers in their 20s and 30s, so to speak, they are drawing from minimalism and pattern repetition. They're drawing from, a lot of them are still drawing from modernism. They're sort of combining a lot of these genres together. I think there's also the infusion of world music, the cross-referencing of all these different cultures. In the United States, we have composers now of so many different backgrounds that they're drawing from music from their own countries and using it in a kind of contemporary fashion. There's a lot with multimedia, people doing things with visual imagery, a lot of cross-referencing of disciplines, composers working with visual artists, composers working with dancers, so that the performers, the pianist is on stage with the dancer. It's just the piano concert itself, I think, has evolved. Like in New York City alone, before the pandemic, we had a lot of smaller experimental venues. And we noticed in the past 10 years that these venues that seat anywhere from 60 up to 200, they were basically selling out. They would get full audiences. There was a thing of the new generation is actually appealing to their peers. And they're finding that this music is of great interest. And I think, like I said, a lot of it I think is an outgrowth of what was before. They're just using it in different ways now. Using iPads, generating things off the iPad, Conrad Tao is an Chinese-American pianist who I considered one of the most talented and great pianists of his generation. He's only 25, and he's a composer, pianist, improviser. He can play anything. He has played all the major concertos. And yet when he writes his own music, there's a certain level of experimentation because he's open to working with sound. He likes the idea of sound. Nico Muley, who I played earlier, has been fascinated with the idea of drones, the idea of a sustained sound in writing music over a sustained sound. So they're all experimenting, I think, also with music of daily life, meaning the sounds that they hear, they're using this in the way that they compose as well. That's why I think it's kind of exciting to watch all the different approaches. I will just mention one other thing. There's a project that a student of mine embarked upon. She created it herself, and I'm very, very proud of her and very impressed with what she's done. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the American writer, science fiction writer, Ray Bradbury. He wrote a series of short stories called The Illustrated Man. They're 18 short stories. And what she wanted to do was she asked 9 pianists to actually write their own piano pieces. And she assigned everybody 2 of the 18 short stories. So everybody has 2 of the stories and they have to create piano pieces based on these stories. They can do whatever they want with the keyboard, the inside, electronics, any of that. And that concert is actually next week. And has been working with a visual lighting installation artist who is going to create lighting design around each of the pieces. That will reflect again on the stories. But what's interesting is it's pianists writing the pieces themselves, some of which have written a lot of piano music and others have not written much piano music. So it's actually a great experiment. And I'm really excited to see how this transforms. It's called The Illustrated Pianist is what she's called the project. And so I'm proud of her because she's allowed her own imagination as a pianist and as a performer to really think of ways to keep evolving the concert situation and keep it fresh. The concert is going to be a live concert with limited audience. Obviously it's already sold out, but she's also going to be streaming it. If you want the link, I can definitely send you the link for it.
Our website, yes.
Yeah, she'll be very happy to know that. So, I mean, I think this is what I'm seeing. I see this from a lot of the young composers. They're being very innovative and very forward-looking in how they're gonna use all the elements that they've been trained with. And I think once we are back to live concerts, I think you're gonna see an explosion of new ideas coming forth because all this has been incubating for a year in people's minds.
So my final question, because we come from an academic environment, what would be your tip or suggestion for pianists who didn't experience anything written later than Debussy or Prokofiev or Messiaen, how to try to get into this world, not to get too overwhelmed with techniques, right, with stuff written down on the paper, how to start navigating this really vast world?
Right. Well, I do this. There's a course I teach at Manhattan School of Music called The Pianist in the 21st Century. And this is exactly what we do. I take a lot of the graduate students in the regular classical music division who take the course. And what I do is we figure out what they've already played, composers they've already played from Debussy onward. And we fill in gaps. And I try to also find out, and I do this with my own private students, where their interests lie. What kind of music do they like? If they're very conservative, what I found in the course is that everybody in the class chooses four pieces to work on during the course of the semester. Each piece has to be of a different style and different approach. And if they have a certain gap in their standard contemporary, it's standard 20th century, like someone's never played Bartok, someone's never played Poulenc or never played Copland. They're assigned one of those pieces, as well as pieces that are written much in the middle or later in the century. And so whatever pieces one student is learning, someone else is learning something completely different. So we do it as a seminar. So they're all being exposed to all the different approaches and techniques. And I find if you just ask the student where their interest is, you'll find that it starts to branch out to a point where they get to, they find that they have other interests in other styles of music. One girl didn't realize how much she was fascinated with modernism. And she started learning, you know, Stockhausen Klavierstück number 8, because she thought the piece was so fascinating. Now it's a short piece, but it was very challenging for her, but she really loved doing it. Another girl was completely enamored of George Crumb, so much so that she's now learning both books of Macrocosmos and she wants to record them. I think it starts, I have a series of pieces that I would assign, to see where their interest is. Some students will come back and say, I just don't like this, or, you know, and I'll ask why. But most of them, when they hear other things, they're like, oh, I've never heard that. I want to work on that. Something starting like with Henry Cowell, they're fascinated because it's clusters. Everybody likes to learn the banshee, which is on the inside strings of the piano. People also want, and I think it's important that they learn some of these extended techniques because they're being used so much. And it's now standard rep. That's the weird thing. A lot of conservatories just don't realize that it is standard repertoire now. And we talk a lot in the course also about creative programming, because I think that's crucial to them creating a career for themselves as a performer. They have to be well-rounded in their repertoire. And a lot of them will mix it with standard rep. You'll see, I find they make wonderful connections between standard composers and recent contemporary composers. And I think that's, you know, I always found that fascinating. I used to love to do that myself in my own programming. But I think it's just a question of speaking to the student and then having a list of works that, you know, they should investigate. A lot of it is just exploring, listening, and finding out, because there's so many different performances on YouTube and Spotify and all that, that they can listen to and see live performances. Does that answer your question? I wasn't sure of it.
Yes, thank you very much. This is very educating. So should we ask Dominic, or do we need a few seconds?
Sure. Let me just, hold on, let me get rid of my iPad here. And my pedal. Since I don't need it anymore. Okay, and so he's playing number 9? I mean, number 13?
Yes, hello. I'm gonna play number 13, and maybe if we have a time, 15 also.
Okay, but great.
Maybe we can start with 13.
Okay, Noel.
Thank you.
Oh, one second. In case I have to spot something. I have to switch now to instructor mode. Oh, it's gonna come through here, right? Okay, so I can put this up here. Thank you. Great. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great job. Really, really. I'm going to just talk about a few little things, just certain things. I'm always about sound, the sound that you're making at the keyboard. The opening is great. I mean, you really, I think, achieve the sound of bells. One little suggestion is just to enhance that even more is maybe bring out on all those chords in the right hand, bring out the top note just a little bit more. Just really let that top note ping. It'll add to that luminescence of the bell-like sound. Now, one of the things I noticed is, and you're doing Massillon's pedaling, and just for anyone there, just this is crucial in Massillon's music, is that his pedal markings have to be followed to the mark, okay? Because when he's really thought this out. And then of course, where there aren't any pedal markings, you can use it discreetly as long as everything is still primarily clear. But again, he builds on resonance as well. One thing, and I don't know if this is the keyboard, at the bottom of the first page, each time you have this, get off it. You were holding it. You were letting it ring. It should be really sort of brusque and dramatic. Just try, can you just try the, we'll just play the opening again, if you would. Okay. can't hear me when he's playing. Ah, okay, got it, okay. That third line, those last three chords up here, really be the peak of what you've just created. They sort of get masked, okay? The top note thing was much better this time. Just do it one more time from the beginning, okay? To do that, sorry, I feel so weird. Great, that was much better. Now, right at that spot where we just were, can you? You've got this. You see, notice that on the low E flat F. No, but it's accented, but it's really dry. It's got to be da da dee dee ba dee dee da da ba. Okay, so because then the next time he does it, he gives you the rings that he wants it to ring. He gives you the vibrato rings. So just this, if you can just make those forzandos really cut off dry. Okay, try that. They're still ringing. Da, da, dee, dee. Better. Do you hear it?
Yes, I can hear it.
No. I can't hear what you're saying.
Oh. Yes, I can hear it now. I think it's, okay. Yeah, it's better.
Okay. Okay, do that and go on from there. Do that again and go on from there.
Yeah, sure.
And continue from there. That was all much better. I had another mark. Can you, on right there on page 92, the third system last measure, the fortissimo, can that again be a little bit more like you're just ripping it off the keyboard? It's a little understated. Do you know what I mean by that?
Okay. Yeah, I can try it, but it's hard.
Just sort of let your finger go right into the keys.
Okay.
So
maybe.
Much better. Now, what you did here, which was good, is that after you played the, went back to the, that you separated it before you started it. So you gave it a great attack, which gave you more power and more weight ability to get it to ring out. Okay, does that make sense?
Okay. Yes.
Good. Okay. What did I say? Okay, go from the tre motore at page 93.
Okay.
Good. This is, I had marked here, can the more luminous, like very quiet, you're still in piano,
just keep it, if they can just be sort of almost like silk, okay? And then the heartbeats, if they can be, they should be next to nothing. Fight to hear them. They should be very, very short and very dry and very thin, okay? Try from wherever it's convenient. You want to go from the third system there?
Sure.
Okay. Better. This can still be. Can start. I think it's when you attack the, when you press the chord. Just a moment to when it switches to both hands. Okay, try it. It's getting better. It's still, I think it could still be a little silkier. Are you staying how close to the?
Excuse me? I didn't understand, sorry.
Say again?
I didn't understand you, sorry.
No, I was just saying, it was just a question of how close to the keys you are when you're playing the group of 10 to keep it even quieter. Are you using your soft pedal?
No.
Try using the soft pedal there and see if it makes a difference.
Okay.
Better, better. Okay, go ahead from there. Now, in this next section, make sure got to sing through. Okay, sometimes it was a little covered. Okay, so go right on that. Now, are you using your soft pedal there? In that whole section? No? Okay,
because
try it.
Mezzo forte.
No. I mean back at the bottom of 93.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that will help. Once you get to the mezzo forte, of course, take it off. But I think that will help. Just try to keep also these, keep, you want these as masked as possible, okay?
Okay.
Okay, try right on that again. A little slower. I think your tempo is now too fast.
Okay,
try it. It's going to be easier, I think, if you go a little slower. Da da dee. Let it really sing, but you can go just slightly. So go use the tempo that you began at the Tre Motore, because that was a good tempo. Okay, try it. Good. Good, good. Much better, much better. Yeah, I think what helps this whole section is the tempo. If you can sustain that tempo, because it allows you to be, it allows it to sing more. And also, I'm hearing a lot more of the distinguishing on the dynamics. They're starting to come through much more clearly. Good. The rest of that question? Oh, without someone. Oh, okay. Let's do this. Just go finish. Let's just finish from there. We'll go to the end, okay? Okay. From the tray beef. Make sure, off.
Okay.
Yeah, make sure those really have to be, I mean, you can pedal them, but they gotta come right up, okay? Good, another, just a trick you could do on at 97, on the second system there, your mezzo forte was great, and you got to the forte, the più forte. When you get to the crescendo, pull it back just a little. So that you can, it'll make the crescendo much more effective, okay? That's just a suggestion to help that. Good, this is actually quite good. It's very rhythmic. It's just a question of smoothing out some of those quieter sections, but I would, you know, at those points where I suggested using the soft pedal, I would do that, because I think it's gonna help the color a lot. Okay, do you wanna play a little of 15? Do we have time? Okay, why don't we just do, you wanna just do the, I mean, it's about, how long? It's about 11 and 12 minutes, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
How much time do we have?
Let's work maybe in fragments.
Say again?
Maybe, can we work in fragments, for
Yes, example? We can. Yeah, I'm curious about the opening. Why don't you go from the opening up to the top of 113? Is that okay?
I'm not sure because it's really new.
Well, you tell me, where do you want to go? Tell me what you're comfortable with.
Maybe let's start with the beginning, please. And okay. Then maybe
okay. We can. Sure. Great. Thank you. Okay, should we work from there? Good. Good. The opening is actually quite beautiful. What I like in these first two pages or so is I like how you balance, you really balance the dynamics. And of course, using the soft pedal on the triple P's helps enormously. The only thing that I noticed that, where was it? Yeah, it's, and this might have just because it was the beginning, is the second system on the first page. When you get, let's say, settle. Each time we come to that F sharp major, it's just got to feel like you just wrap someone in a blanket, okay? And the thing is that you did that. The thing is, I played this a few years ago, and I know that once you keep playing these sections over and over as he repeats it, they get easier and easier. You feel more embedded into the keyboard. That's what I always found with this particular piece. And then it starts to get comfortable. Let's just work. What I want to just focus on is, and it's tricky, it's not so much the trills, it's what's going on underneath it that we have to keep. It has to stay full, okay, in terms of the sound. I'm just trying to think, what's a good place to start? Let's go from on page 110, the second system. Well, why don't you start at the top of the page? Start at the top of the page of 110.
Okay.
Okay. That was great. When you get to the end of the second system there, don't hesitate before you get to the third line, to those chords. You want to make sure that keeps going. So what were those chords again? Sorry, I haven't played this in a while. Make sure that leads to that accented chord. It's just a slight accent, okay? Just go from the all mouvement, okay? Your tempo this time also at the all mouvement was much better because it was, you held back just a little. I mean, he wants it to move forward, but you don't have to push, okay? Try it. My point earlier was you landed on this great, but then it goes, you go right. I don't know. You had a little bit of a slip there, so you want to make sure that goes on. Here we, and then the section we just stopped at. Get those. You can keep the 32nd notes really quiet, okay? Try right on that. Really voice that inner note. Sure. slide. My notes aren't right, sorry. Can that really connect in the left hand with the grace from chord to chord each time? Don't think about the trill right now. Just think about really letting that line come through at the top of 111 at the end of that first line there, okay? Try from just at the beginning of that page, 111, okay? There. That was actually really beautiful. That was so much better up there. Now, one thing, this is minor, but third system, second measure, end of the measure, that last trill, don't start your trill until you've played the grace note. So keep the, let the trill on the actual E sharp and G sharp. Okay, that's just minor. Go on from there, the all mouvement.
Okay, the third system, yeah?
The third system, sure. When you started nicely. Now here, this has got to move. Can that move just a little bit more? It should feel like it's almost like at the tipping point, and then it falls. It's like falling down a hill. Okay, try that. I'm just thinking about your pedaling here. It could be, gosh, I wish I had the notes in my hands. You can pedal, you know what I would do? Try pedaling each phrase individually. Okay, and make the changes more half pedal changes. Okay, because otherwise it sounds choppy and you want it to really flow all the way through to the end. Okay, try that. How much more can you crescendo that going down to the bass? So when you land at the, okay, really, really crescendo that. Do again from the place. Okay, yeah, that's good. Yeah, same spot. Good. And then those tremolos you can extend a little bit more. Really listen in the rallentando, listen for the decay of the crescendo, okay? You don't want it to happen too quickly, okay? So that, I think that's the reason he gives you the rallentando is he wants you to really listen to how that's really dying away, okay? That was better. The other thing is these, your pedal, I know they're phrased individually, but don't change the pedal till you played the first note of the new phrase. That will help glue it, okay? Otherwise, there's a little bit of a gap that we get between the phrases, and you don't want that, okay? That's just something to just to practice. Okay, how much time, do you want to go on from there? Oh, okay. It's up to you. Do you want to go on from there?
Yes, we can try.
Okay. Let's talk about that. I have one question. On page 116, in the Preseum Pur, on the end of the third system, just a suggestion, there's some of those notes in the bottom staff, are you taking some of those with the right hand?
No.
You can. It might make your life easier, okay? And it also makes the flow easier. What I would suggest, this is, maybe we could do this another time. I could, if you write me, I could tell you which ones. Like in that beginning of it, the G in the bottom staff there, that G can be taken up with the, a right hand. That might make that easier because then you can reach C up with the C. You see what I'm doing? Is the right hand, that's the left.
Yes.
If you go through this section, you'll find if you do that, it makes it much easier because you have to keep, he wants you to start getting faster and it makes the manipulation much easier to do, okay?
That's
so that's place. Something, say again?
That's a horrible place to play.
I know. Okay, what was I gonna say? Let me see, if this, this, if that, again, just that left hand, those upper notes of the chords, if those can really voice out a little more. And then now he gives you those long phrases on that next line. You want to make sure that that really is smooth. Just start there once again at the motor A. That rallentando is not enough. You can, and this will make your life easier. Use it more, do more of it, okay? When you get there, da, 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 and then start your motor A, okay? Just go from wherever, on the third line, wherever you want in there. Maybe. Okay, no, that's fine, that's fine. Okay. Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. One thing is the after the rallentando, when you start the presque vif, you know what will make this easier is really give us the, even in a piano dynamic, give us those accents. Accentuate that, because I think that will help. It will help the momentum as it starts to build in that regard. What was I going to say? All through that section. And then on the next page, 116 at the top, the un peu plus long, I would really pull back even slower than what you were doing, because it's going to help when you have to start to get faster, okay? You'll have much more momentum there. Again, on this page, what I would suggest, go through, starting with the second system, and see which notes in the left hand can be taken with the right hand. To make it easier. I think that's going to really help that, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Good. Good. I think, are we out of time? Oh, we have 3 minutes. Did you want to just finish it and then just to allow you to finish it?
I'm not sure. It's up to you. Again, because it's very new for me, so.
I know. I realize it's new. And it's hard. You were in one of the hardest sections. I know,
yeah,
it's tricky. How long have you worked on it?
For maybe 3 or 2 weeks, something.
Oh,
like that.
Wow. Okay. Well, that's good work for 2 or 3 weeks. What I would suggest—I mean, you have to live with this. I didn't perform it until after about 4 months, just because I wanted. Because Maceon, you got to get in the system, you know, because he forces you. It's like reading Scriabin sometimes. You have to really look closely at what he's after. Good. Okay. Well, we'll stop there then. And I think you're on, I mean, you're on the way. It's just a question of it's just got to get more comfortable.
Yes.
But I really commend you on the opening because you really have a good balance in the sound there between those dynamics. Good. This is great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Anthony, again.
Thank you, Adam. It was a wonderful experience
for us, and we wish you all the best.
Same here. I hope to talk to you soon again.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, bye.